Would you stand with me as we sing together number 840 in your songbooks? 840, what a day that'll be. 840 in your hymn book.
There is coming a day when no heartache shall come.
Thank you for coming. I know the family would like to thank you for coming and taking time to come and reflect on a life well lived. And it would be hard to keep it short if you really spent time about what Billy was really all about. What a privilege to know him and to see his faith, to see his love for people, to see his love for his family and his servant spirit. I loved coming in on Sundays and seeing him back there at that door and greeting people and greeting them on the way out. And I think of the many fun times we had at the Golden Corral. I told Linda, and I don't know if I can go back there now without Billy. We always did dessert first because we didn't want to take the chance of not having room for dessert after. So we loved gummy bears and Swedish fish, and we just loved to spend time together. And What a blessing to know a servant, a real true servant. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to bless this time. Father, our hearts are heavy, but they're also glorifying in the fact that we know that Billy's faith has become sight. Father, no more pain, no more hurt, no more sorrow for him. So Father, I pray you'd be with his family. Lord, I pray you'd be with his loved ones, all those friends. Lord, as there's a new normal to navigate, Lord, I pray as we reflect on a life well-lived and a wife well-loved, that we thank you for Linda's faithfulness to take care and to help. And Lord, I thank you for Billy. And again, one day we'll see him again. And I pray, Lord, that that day would be quick. We look forward to you coming back. I pray today that everything that is done would bring honor and glory to you. And again, Lord, we thank you for the privilege it has been to know Billy on this side of glory. And Father, we're so thankful for the hope that we have in Christ, yes, that we will see him again, yes, on the best side in glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please be seated.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and when yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. All the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, or on the hands that hold you now? The road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. But now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, there won't be long. No such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, or on the hands that hold me now? Goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the bitter parts of me, until I'm standing with you in the sun. Fight this fight in this race I'll run, until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, all belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new, and the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, or on the hands that hold you now?
For our scripture reading today, I'm going to be reading from a well-known, a familiar passage, I'm sure to many of you, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. This is where the Apostle Paul reminds the believers there in the church of the tremendous comfort and hope that we have because of the resurrection of Christ. So I just invite you to listen as we read this passage, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words.
When engulfed by the terror of tempestuous sea, unknown waves before you roll, at the end of doubt and peril is eternity. Though fear and conflict grip your soul, but just think of stepping on shore and finding it heaven, of touching a hand and finding it God's, of breathing new air and finding it celestial. When surrounded by the blackness of the darkest night, oh, how lonely death can be. At the end of this long tunnel is a shining light, for death is swallowed up in victory. But just think of stepping on shore and finding it heaven, of touching a hand and finding it God's, of breathing new air and finding it celestial, of waking up in glory. Finding it home, I'm kind of homesick for a country to which I've
Good morning. My name is John Quendi, and I was Billy's son-in-law. I married his daughter, Rachel. And our family would like to thank each of you for being here today and taking part in the celebration of Billy's life. And over the last several years, Billy was met with several challenges. But through all of those challenges that he faced, you know, through all the pain that he experienced, through all the difficulties he knew, and through all the discouragement he dealt with, anybody that knew Billy would tell you that Billy never lost his joy. I think one way that joy can easily be expressed is through God's gift of laughter that he's given to us. You know, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 17 that a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 references a time to laugh. Billy loved to laugh. And despite his challenges, he never had difficulty finding the humor in a situation, whether that was snickering at a joke somebody told, or laughing at one of his grandkids crawling across the floor, or sneaking a piece of candy that he was not supposed to have. Billy loved to share the laughter. So in the spirit of that, we'd like to share some of those lighter memories here with you today. We know we mentioned how Billy enjoyed sneaking a piece of candy covertly, but due to some of his health concerns, he wasn't allowed to eat a lot of candy or sweets. Now, my daughter, McKenna, Billy's granddaughter, just so happens to have that same sweet tooth that Billy had. And so it wasn't uncommon to see them together sneaking candy and passing it back and forth between the two of them like true partners in crime. You know, Billy was also known to sneak some candy into his pockets and enjoy snacking away out of sight of any potential investigators of his activities. A common occurrence of this was at the Partlow's house when he would go get up to, quote, use the restroom. Now, what made this suspicious was that the fact that he frequently seemed to go the opposite direction of the restroom, but in the same direction as the candy bowl. Linda may have gotten more than one phone call about that from Beth a time or two. Now, not everyone was always aware of what Billy could and could not have. I remember a time Rachel and I visited their family in Louisiana just a few years ago and found Billy eating and drinking just about anything his heart desired. Now, his sisters were shocked to find out that most of what he had been enjoying were things that he wasn't supposed to have. For some reason, Billy seemed to have conveniently forgotten to mention any of that to them. Now, not all of Billy's adventures had to do with snacks. As a matter of fact, when he was young, he actually fell out of a boat. He was terrified, and he started splashing and yelling, and he was afraid that he was drowning right then and there. It wasn't until some of his friends looked over and they said, "Hey, Billy, stand up." At that point, he was relieved to discover that the water was barely to his knees. Our last story happened just not long ago. Billy, unfortunately, was in the hospital recovering from a fall that had just happened and heard the phone ringing in his hospital room. He promptly grabbed the handset to find out who was trying to reach him, and he was a little bit surprised to find out that the ringing he heard was on the TV, and the phone that he answered was actually the TV remote. It happens. In addition to those stories, we'd also like to share some facts that Billy was just famous for. As a school administrator, Billy would point with two fingers when someone needed his attention, or more often, when a troublemaking student needed his. Then everybody in that whole general direction would have to figure out who it was that was in trouble and got to take the walk. He took a cup of coffee with him everywhere he went, and then he would leave it there. So you always knew which room he had just been in. When it came to meals, as was mentioned before, Billy preferred to eat dessert first and then save the main course until after that was done. Billy absolutely hated broccoli. His keys would jingle as he would walk down the hall, so that was always a nice way to instill fear into the hearts of the students that was down the hall at the schools. Though Billy was not able to serve as an usher at church due to some of his physical limitations, one thing he certainly could do was to hold the doors open for everyone as they walked in and out of church. And he enjoyed hearing everyone thank him as he faithfully served. You know, we all miss Billy. And for those that knew him well, you're going to continue to miss him. You'll miss them long after the condolences stop, after the text messages from friends stop buzzing on your phone, and after the cards stop showing up on your desks, and after the Facebook messages, they'll stop hitting your inboxes, but the loss will still be there. But I'll end with this. For those of us who know Christ as our Savior, we have that same joy that Billy knew. That joy is the hope of heaven, where one day as children of God, we'll see Billy again. And we'll once again get to hear Billy's laughter that we're all going to miss so much. Thank you for the opportunity to share some memories here with you today. God bless you all.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who came to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose. With angels and the saints, we raise a mighty roar.
Thank you, ladies. As we, as Christians, look at all of the different things that God asks us to do and God asks us to navigate, I am thankful for His Word. I'm thankful for the promise that He gives us, that He assures us of His presence. And I'm very, very honored to be able to be up here this afternoon and be speaking. I know that there are many individuals who could have much to say. I know that Billy loved each and every one of the men that he worked with as pastors, and that there are many other pastors that could come up here and could do a much more eloquent and much better job of this, but I've been given this opportunity. Are there any other pastors here that you had the chance to pastor Billy or work with Billy on the field? Is there anyone? You raise your hand real quick. Is there anyone here? Just looking around. There's a number of them out there and about. I've met a few of them. Of course, Pastor Kelly's in heaven. We're thankful for that. And looking at trying to figure out what to say. A lot of times, as a pastor, you spend a lot of time trying to figure out what to say. But I want the family, friends to know this is one of the funerals when you're trying to figure out what to leave out. And how are you going? You can't wrap up his life in a couple of minutes. You just can't do it. And I know that we're here for a number of reasons. Of course, many of us are here to show our love and support for this family because they're special to us. We're here to think on Billy because he was special to us. We're here to praise his Savior. We're here to thank the Lord for what he did through Billy Auld's life. And as we grieve the passing of a much loved, respected, kind, and caring individual, we wonder, what is it that God has for us? It's interesting in Ecclesiastes that the Bible tells that this is actually better for each and every one of us than going to a feast or going to a party. I don't know about you, if I had a choice, and I say this at most funerals, I would not choose to be here. But the Bible says that it's important for us because we will take it to heart. And when I met with a family earlier this week, I told you I already had the message written up. I've written four of them. And the fourth one was the one that I liked, and I told you, I got it, I know what we're doing. And then what you shared with me that day, his three verses, I changed it again and decided to just take a little bit of a different approach. When Paul was writing to the church at Corinth, he was trying to help them because there were some people that had come along and they had given false teaching. And they had showed up with letters of recommendation saying, hey, this is what we're here to teach you something about God, and here's our letter proving that we know what we're saying. And Paul kind of rebukes them, and he says this very kindly, but he says something in 2 Corinthians 3. He says, do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? What he's saying is, do I really need to prove the truth that we've taught? Do I really need to prove what it is that God has told us? And he says something interesting. He says in verse 2, ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart. And I would propose to you here this afternoon, this morning, that God has written to each and every one of us a letter. He hasn't chiseled it on tablets like he did the Ten Commandments. He hasn't written it on parchment like some of the early New Testament passages were written. He's written it on your heart. He's written it with Billy ink. He's used Billy Auld's to write an important testimony. And honestly, this still is a difficult thing to limit. But the three verses that you shared with me in the living room, that Billy was special to him, those, I don't know if you knew this, those, they fit together wonderfully. You're familiar with probably most of them. The first one, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. You familiar with that one? Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not to your own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he'll direct thy paths. Then the other verse that Linda shared with me that was special to Billy, another verse, was Romans 8. For we know that all things work together for good, to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. And then the last one, and she said in the ambassadors one. Now we are ambassadors for Christ. And as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be reconciled to God. And so I'd like to talk just for a couple of moments this morning about the letter that God has written on your heart by using the special ink of the life of Billy Joe Auld. Because there are a number of things that we could focus on, but I want to focus on one in particular. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Billy had a lifetime of trusting the Lord. Now, we know that he's not perfect, and I'm looking at folks on the front row that know he's not perfect, because you got to see him in the non-perfect times sometimes, right? And you got to see in some of the different opportunities when the sinful flesh still proved its presence. But Linda, when you and Billy met, and you married right next door, and then when you decided to go to Okinawa and decided to go to Puerto Rico, you were doing that because you're trusting in the Lord, not leaning to your own understanding. The first time I met the Alls was in Puerto Rico. It was my first missions trip outside of the country. And Billy taught me a lot of different things. One thing that he taught me, I haven't shared this with you yet, Linda, I remember we were in the cafeteria area we were eating, and I was talking about, we had done some work there at the church, and I needed to find a place to wash. And do you remember? He said, just bring it to Linda and she'll wash it. Linda was behind him, and I wasn't married to Linda, but I could understand the look that she shot across the room when she heard Billy say, just bring it in and Linda will wash it. And I thought, oh my, I don't want to be the reason why this couple comes off the field. I said, hey, you know, we'll look. We'll try to find a laundromat or something. But I got to spend that time and got to meet Billy for the first time there in Puerto Rico and minister with him and serve him. And can I tell you honestly, Billy did not plan on this for his life. And here's the amazing thing to me, is that every Christian that I've come across, and I know family, and there's going to be different moments when you're going to be tempted to think that what you have to face isn't right. It's not good. And I could preach a wonderful flowery sermon about how trusting the Lord and not leaning to your own understanding because all things work together for good. But I don't have to preach as long a sermon. I just have to ask you, read the letter that he wrote with Billy Auld's ink. Because God asked a question in the Old Testament. He says, doesn't the potter have power over the clay? And we say, amen. Billy did not know, as God was going to let his life unfold, that in our eyes, he was going to mar that piece of clay. In our eyes, it was going to turn out very, very differently than what we anticipated. In our eyes, it was going to be a different daddy than what we thought we'd have, a different husband than we thought we'd have. And yet, Billy still trusted in the Lord with all of his heart. He didn't lean on his own understanding. If he would have leaned on his own understanding, he wouldn't have been a happy fella. He wouldn't have been a joy to be around. But Billy was willing to live as a broken vessel. Improve the goodness of God. Because God is not good when our bodies work well and we have a fat bank account and all of our children are good looking and our wives are nice to us and our husbands are kind to us and we win the lottery. God is good all the time. And Billy was a living epistle of that. He was God's writing that earlier in Romans 8:28, it says, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the future weight of glory that God's going to lay out for us. And Billy could live that life because he understood that he could trust God. You say, well, then why the struggles? And family, I want you to remember, even Jesus Christ struggled with God's will for his life. You remember in the garden, he said, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. But then he said, not my will, but thine. I'm sure that there were times that Billy thought he would want this cup to pass from him. But instead, he said, okay, Lord, I'm going to live as a broken vessel the only way I know how. And that is giving God the glory. And nothing could rob his joy. I did not know exactly what John was going to say. But what a wonderful testimony. The next time that you're tempted to think that your life is difficult, pull out that letter in your mind and read a little bit of that epistle that's written on your heart in Billy ink. Think about the last time that you saw him in the lobby, joyful to be holding a door, joyful to be saying hi to you. I remember the last time I sat with him in the hospital and was talking to him about some things that we're going to do in the church, and he got so excited and was asking questions, and I could tell he was in pain, but he was just so happy, just thinking on the Lord and thinking about the chance to share the gospel with others. And so I want you to think about that, and I want you to understand that last verse that we shared, the second verse that we shared, that all things work together for good, Billy did not limit God and say, God, I have to see the good. God, I have to recognize the good. It has to be good to me for me in order to trust you. He said, no, I'm going to trust with all my heart. And if you say you're going to do good, I'm just going to wait. And that's what he did. And then the last thing to share with you, the last verse, says we're ambassadors for Christ as though God did beseech you by us. What that verse means is listen to the message that we are sharing. Paul is saying, listen to the message because it's as if Christ is talking. And here is what he says, be ye reconciled to God. As I look over this crowd, many of you, if not most of you, I recognize. I know that many of you claim to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. But I can only look on the outward appearance. I cannot see your heart. And the letter that has been inked with Billy Auld's ink that we're looking at today cries out, be reconciled to God. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, listen, it's not a prayer. It's not getting dunked in a tank. It's not going through some religious ritual. It's a relationship. You know what a relationship is. Some of you have a relationship with the family. Some of you had a relationship with, you know what it's like. Some of you in here, many of you in here, you know that because of your program, you know who I am. You can say my name, but you don't have that relationship. The ink that has been inked and laid out before you this morning is make sure that you are reconciled to God. And first and foremost, I want to talk to you that don't know Christ. You can repent. You can ask the Lord to be your Savior here this morning. You can get that same Savior to give you that same ability to trust in Him regardless of the outcome. But then I also want to talk to those of you Christians that the wear and tear of life has gotten to you. I know there's some in here today. And maybe there's not some in here right now, but maybe it'll come in the future. When the hardships of life, when the difficulty, when the struggle is going to come, and you're going to be tempted to think it's not worth it. I want to challenge you. Pull this letter out again. It's awfully hard to read the epistle written in Billy Auld's ink and say, I have a reason to be upset, isn't it? It's awfully hard to read that letter and say, I have a reason to have a bad day. I have a reason to stay away from work. I have a reason to make life difficult for other people. Because Billy has lived for us. You can trust in the Lord with all your heart. You don't have to figure out all of the steps that He has laid out for you. You can rest in Him. He'll bring it to pass because all things work together for good to them that love God. And if you know Jesus, you know that you love God. And the Bible says that the ambassadors for Christ clearly call out, and everybody in here would say the same thing that knows Jesus. Come to Him. Accept Him as your Savior. But if you've wandered away, if your heart's grown cold, maybe your heart hasn't even grown cold. Maybe you've just gotten busy. Be ye reconciled to God. One of the joys that the Bible tells us is that we have an opportunity as Christians to show Christ. And it is amazing to me how God uses broken vessels to show His glory. But it is also a very, very sobering thing to each and every one of us who are not a broken vessel. We have no excuse. We should shine brightly for God. We should live the testimony. Kids, I don't know what your future holds. But you've got some pretty big shoes. Daddy showed Christ even in difficulty. And I know, listen, nobody else here knows the weight that you carry. They don't. There are some caregivers in this room, but nobody else knows the weight that you've carried looking at Daddy. And I want to encourage you, remember what the sum of His book says. I know one thing, He loved you guys. He always, for, I don't know why, I don't know if he did this at home, but always with me, it was always Micah, my boy. I don't know if he did that with anybody else, but I would always talk to him. He'd talk about Rachel and Stephanie and Micah, my boy. It's like, I know which one's the boy, Billy. I am aware, you know. Wasn't sure exactly what he was doing, but he'd always, with just such joy in talking. And I know this is a difficult thing. But see, God's writing on your heart as well. Linda, God's writing on your heart as well. And as God gives grace, I pray that your letter will be as encouraging and as challenging as Billy Joe Walt's. What a blessing. Let's bow our hearts together in prayer. Lord, we thank you for the goodness that even though we can't always see and understand and immediately agree with, we thank you that it is there. Lord, I pray that you would show yourself powerful to this dear family, that you would wrap your arms around, Lord, each and every one of them, Lord, the sisters, the nieces and nephews, grandkids, Lord, everyone that life has now changed because they can no longer see Billy face to face, can no longer talk with him, can no longer laugh with him. Lord, I thank you that you have warmed our hearts toward heaven, that you've turned us a little bit closer toward home, helped us focus and see what it is that you have for us. Lord, I pray for those folks that are here. If there's somebody here that doesn't know you, I pray that, Lord, they would recognize the wonderful testimony that's before them, that you're not a God that offers perfection. You're not a God that offers ease. You're not a God that offers a life filled with nothing but joy and fun. You are a God that offers to redeem if we come. And I thank you for redeeming Billy and making that evident in so many facets of his life. So, Lord, I pray that if there's someone here that doesn't know you, that today would be the day of salvation. And, Lord, I pray for those folks that are hurting. Lord, the difficulty they've been facing in their life, the hardship that they have gone through, Lord, that they would be reconciled to you, that they would understand there's no better place than standing with you, even if you're standing as a broken vessel. Lord, encourage them, strengthen them. May you be honored and lifted up, and may you receive all the glory. Lord, we love you. Thank you for loving us. In the name of our precious Redeemer and Savior and friend, we ask these things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with me, please, as we sing together Amazing Grace? If you need it, it's 187 in your songbook. 187 in your songbook. Let's sing it together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Grace that taught.
This will conclude the service here. The next service will be over at the Celestial Gardens. And we're not, there's not a processional going there, so you need to make your way over that way as soon as you can. The family is not going to take time right now to greet you. If you'd like to see the family, you can do that after the graveside at the cemetery. But we need to get over there because of some time constraints. So if you could head that way right now, we would appreciate it. God bless you. We'll see you over at Celestial Gardens in just a few minutes.